sadly died at Christmas. In the next hour, you'll hear some memories from us and our studio guests, including Status Quo's original tour manager, co-songwriter and harmonica player Bob Young,
Don Powell from Slade and Andy Scott from Sweet,
Alan G. Parker, who was the producer of the Hello Quo documentary, which actually got the Frantic Four back together again,
my old mate and Quo original, Alan Lancaster, all the way from Australia,
and Rick's son, Rick Parfitt Jr., with some lovely memories of his dad.
We can promise you some great stories and music to celebrate Rick's life.
So let's start with my choice of song, an absolute tribute to Rick, Don't Drive My Car. That was Don't Drive My Car. Our first guest today is Bob Young, who was Quo's original tour manager, as well as their co-songwriter, harmonica player and great mate. He told us his earliest memories of Rick.
When they were wearing the flares, as John will well know, the poppy stuff and the silly haircuts and all of that, that was really my first memory of them in the Pictures of Magic Men days when that was out. And Rick was then a bit of a joker, always the one with the joke and the silly jokes, which he then carried on with for the next 50 years. And I thought, well, if this lasts me for another few weeks, I'll be laughing, you know. And there it is 50 years later.
Yeah, I remember Rick, he used to phone me up at home and say, look, I'm bored. I'll come up in the car, pick you up, and we go up to London, because he lived in Byfleet and I was in South London then. And he used to drive up in a Singer Gazelle, lovely little car, and we go up to Wardour Street to La Chasse for a drink. Then we go into the Marquee for a drink. If we didn't like the band, we'd go somewhere else. In those days, Rick was such a funny man, you know.
One thing about Rick, I don't think he changed very much in all of his time. He was always the blonde rock star with an eye for the ladies. He loved a car, loved his cars. And
he had some cars, Bob, didn't he? Because I remember he loved Porsches, and he bought a Rolls Royce, got fed up with that, sold that, and got another Porsche. And this is me with my much-beloved Range Rover, and I was happy with that.
Yeah. Well, I was happy to be driving the van, the 1700-weight Transit, with the equipment in it and the band who usually wanted to travel in there. Fun old days, and I'm just sort of very grateful, I guess, to... I've had 50 years with him and written a few songs, you know.
You wrote a lot of songs with Rick, didn't you?
Yes, I did, yeah. And I'm very happy to have got that, as my lasting memories as well.
Which is the favourite of the songs that you collaborated on?
I would say if I had to choose a couple of favourites out of all the ones we did, I'd have to say Living on an Island is one, because, you know, I remember the time going over there to Jersey where Rick was staying because of the tax year and the silly times that we had over there. And lyrically, that song is all about Jersey. You know, Huey's got a real nice place. Huey was a guy that owned a club in Jersey that, you know, we all used to go and drink in. I think it was never a song that was expected to be a status quo song, really, because of being so sort of laid back. But it worked, and it's still a popular song, I think, within the Quo catalogue. And the other one was Paper Plane, you know. That for me was a big one too. It was a period of madness with Quo when they were in the studio, and Rick sat up all night while we all went back to the hotel and back home and came back in the next morning, and he was still sitting on the stool playing the riff to Paper Plane. And from there, you know, we then wrote the lyrics and everything. But that particular song, Live, I think, is one of the real exciting songs that the band played.
Yeah, definitely.
How did you write the songs with Rick?
The writing with Rick was always different to, say, writing with Francis, in so much as with Francis we were fairly disciplined. With Rick, we were not so disciplined. You know, we could spend all night thinking we were writing a song and end up with nothing. But we, you know, we usually came out with something, because with Francis, we didn't drink or do anything. Well, I don't think we did, or maybe I just can't remember that we did.
we did.
But Francis was never a drinker, and Rick was. But it was always, always a lot of fun, always.
Everything with Rick was always a lot of fun and just huge amount of laughs. I think that's everybody's happy memories of him.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, it's a big loss to all of us, you know, but you know, he was a great friend, and you know, and it's sad that he's gone, and it's nice to be doing this little tribute to him today.
Finally, Bob, what memory will you hold closest to you to remember him by?
Fun, laughter, unpredictable in lots of ways, but always, always a pleasure to be with. Easy when you're number one. Everybody.
And that was Bob Young's choice, Living on an Island, on Rockers Rolling.
Our next guest and friend is Don Powell, the drummer from Slade. We met many times on the road, and he remembers the first time we played together.
I'm sure it was a college in Hereford, late 60s, and I always remember that because, you know, you remember hot pants, you know,
I mean,
with the fashion. And there's a lot of these girls at this gig wearing hot pants, and Rick sort of coined this phrase, like the Hereford Hots. And it sort of stuck with us ever since. Yeah, I'm just checking my diaries, and it was the 6th of May, 1969, we played the Park Ballroom, Hereford.
Wow, that
and
is
that was,
fantastic.
That was the one when that was our very first meeting, Slade and Quo together.
Wow.
Well, what a very happy meeting that was for all of us, and what great friends we've all made since.
And it's been like that ever since, isn't it, guys?
It has. Yeah. John and I still see Noddy for regular lunches and drinks, and... It's just awful that one of us is now missing.
Well, we can talk fondly about him, though.
Oh, very fondly. I think he'll never be forgotten. He was your ultimate front man, wasn't he?
I'll tell you what you say in that, Gillie. I remember I had a black, like a bullfighter's jacket once, and we did Top of the Pop together, and he was trying all night to get this jacket off me. He wanted to wear it on stage. But his strength, he was like, he must be the best sort of rhythm player I've ever heard, really.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, we're talking about Roll Over, Lay Down, and things like that. I mean, he was the ace rhythm player. I mean, you couldn't sort of say he was like a second guitarist or whatever. He was just as important as everybody else in the band. I mean, but just his rhythm playing and on Whatever You Want and things like that would just leave some bounds in front of everyone else.
What would your favourite track be, do you think?
Well, I think Roll Over, Lay Down was the one that sort of got me with basically Rick's playing, his style of playing. It was just like, it was so much on the button, and it was there, you know. I mean, you know, a really an integral part of the band.
Yeah, because I think we all participated in the arrangement and the writing in that song. And
that's what makes a band, is when you all sit down and all put your oar in, and you can feel it, can't you, when all the band sort of hit it off together.
Don, what will be your lasting memory of Rick?
Well, I remember occasionally we'd meet sort of at some concert somewhere, and we'd always end up going somewhere nice and quiet and just chatting and drinking and, you know, sort of enjoying ourselves and just reminiscing and just what we've been doing today, really. And it was always a great thing. He was wonderful. We always look forward to sort of bumping into him and having a great few hours together.
And that was the classic roll over, lay down. Time to have a chat with another member of the Frantic Four now. We phoned Alan in Australia and asked him if he could remember the first time he met Rick.
When we first met was at Butlin's. It was our first professional gig together as the Spectres. John, I remember that well.
Yeah.
And Rick used to come round to the Rock and Roll Ballroom with the twins, you know, Gloria and Jean. He was doing a cabaret act in the Gaiety Ballroom. So he used to come round and he used to stand out because he used to wear these suave suits. And I got to know him pretty quickly, and we stayed in contact after Butlin's all through. So we stayed in good mates, and we got him in the band in the end.
You started writing songs with Rick, didn't you? Way back,
right from the Butlin's days, actually. We kind of exchanged songs. Well, I remember Rick wrote a little song called Letitia, which is his song, and I wrote a little song called The Omar Girl, I think it was, and we swapped them to work on them.
And you obviously then created a lifelong partnership with him, songwriting, all through until you left the band, in fact.
Yeah, we developed a good relationship writing. Rick was different to everybody else. He kind of had to get a feel going. And I recognised that, and that's what formed the partnership, really, recognising that in each other.
What's your favourite song that you wrote together, Alan, do you think? What are you most proud of writing with Rick?
Well, it's funny, you know, because early memories of Rick is starting off Roll Over, Lay Down. We used to play the piano backstage, driving everyone nuts. I mean, we all wrote that song together in the end, but it kind of started off with me and Rick on this piano, and then that little riff came in, and John with those tom-toms in the middle, and it became an all-round song. So that was one of the early good ones that I remember writing with Rick. But of course, the biggest memories is the Quo album, because we basically almost wrote that album together.
And that was
the arrangements were very important, and like every one of us put arrangements in all our songs. We didn't write every single part of the song. It's the band that put those arrangements in to make them what they were. You know, when people say it's all bound down to the music, I think it's all down to the performance, because without a performance, you can't even hear the thing, can you? And that's really where Rick was at. He was never a session musician, was he?
Rick was your ultimate rock star, wasn't he? With his blonde hair flowing and his satin shirts. So what do you miss and remember most about your friend?
Well, Rick, I suppose it's every time we were together. We used to socialise a lot, even though we used to spend a lot of time together in the band. We still used to socialise outside the band. But whenever we got together, it was always an event. There's always something happened. Right from Stringfellow's Club to, you know, Chelsea Des Artistes, we always managed to get into some kind of event.
Alan, I'm sure you could go on all night about funny stories that you and Rick were involved in, but can you give us a couple of happy, funny, clean stories for the radio, please?
Every time we got together with Rick, there was a funny story of some kind, because it was always so much fun. Let the Trail of Heartache behind him, where everyone seemed to get addicted to Rick, and like Rick was always moving forward, sort of looking for the next sort of thing to do. So when he went out with Rick, there was always an air of danger in sight. But, I mean, the earliest things about Rick, I think I remember, like racing down the embankment in Chelsea on the other side of the road, because he's a love speeding, and he got me to race with his car, and I was on the other side of the road racing his car. Absolutely stupid.
Yeah,
the early hours of the morning, things like that, and going round a roundabout the wrong way, you know, in the middle of Woking, and you know, having an accident in his Porsche. We lost it. I both survived that. Crashed into a fence, remember that? And
actually, Al, do you remember we in Australia, we used to party a lot on tour, and, you know, it was always in Rick's room. Then he'd throw us out and we'd go to Francis' room. Then Rick would always turn up with a bottle of wine and something else. And so I was trying to have an early night. Of course, we didn't. We ended up drinking more wine and doing silly things. And I remember sending him down in the lift one night. He was completely naked. I pressed the button and ran away. The lift went round to reception and these people looking at this naked Englishman drunk in the lift.
That must have been a joy.
On a little bit, though, kind of used to do it the daredevilman. I don't think he was really out of it that much to do that. You know, I think it was sort of a bit of an act.
He would have enjoyed
it. Always getting up to things, that was for sure.
And on the reunion tour, remember, because he and Francis had their own tour bus, and Alan and John and I and Dale Lancaster, Alan's gorgeous wife, had our tour bus, and Bob Young. And if we were leaving a gig and driving across Europe,
in the middle of the night, Rick would get bored on his bus with Francis and he'd come and join us on ours with his little ukulele and a bottle of wine, and we'd all sing around the ukulele all night.
Yeah, that was great. That's, I remember right. that. Because he said, oh, I'm fed up with Francis. I said, well, what's wrong with Francis? Oh, he doesn't want to party, he wants to go to sleep. So he left him in his room on his own and he came on our tour bus. But I just think the Rick Parfitt you saw was the Rick Parfitt you got, and that was it. And he said a lovely thing to me when we went to Marbella for young Rick Parfitt's wedding, and he said, what are you doing tomorrow? And I said, well, nothing, we're going to just hang out. And he said, well, come round to the house tomorrow, get a taxi, come round, and you can have lunch. Anyway, it turned out we're sitting by the pool, it was a lovely sunny day, and he said, I'll be with you in a minute. The reason he disappeared, he was cooking Sunday lunch. He cooked roast beef, Yorkshire puddings, potatoes and everything that goes with it. And I said to Rick after, I said, in all the years I've known you, I never knew you could cook. He was an amazing cook.
Because on the reunion tour, he kept insisting he wanted to cook me a shepherd's pie. I mean, for weeks, ages went by, days went by, but he insisted on cooking this. And in the end, I agreed to it, so he cooked it for me. And it was a piss thing I tasted. Best shepherd's pie I ever tasted.
And the best roast potatoes we had in Spain, didn't we? No, yeah. He was a brilliant cook. Hidden talents. A very, very, very lovely man that everybody adored. And you never hear a bad word about him.
We always cooked it up on stage, that was for sure.
That's for sure. So, Al, what will you pick as the song to remember Rick by?
Well, the one that I like most, really, as far as Rick's performance, is Just Take Me. I am just a poor man, got nowhere to go. Let me all alone. If I was a rich man, if I was a king, I would give you all I have, give you everything. Just take me, just take me now, just take me.
This is John and Gillie's Rockers Rolling, our special tribute to Rick Parfitt, and that was Just Take Me.
Our next guest on this special edition of Rockers Rolling is guitarist from Sweet, Andy Scott. He told us how he first met Rick.
We had barely had a hit record and I found myself in the marquee and Rick and Francis were sat there and I was with my missus and they were obviously with theirs, and there was a little bit of, that sort of elephant in the room thing. Because they're obviously looking across thinking, God, he's got long hair, he must be in something. and I knew who they were. We just basically got chatting and it was fantastic from then onwards, really. We then obviously shared an office with David Walker many years later, and I can't tell you half of what went on there. Terribly sorry.
I think I can imagine. If you obviously won't remember, Andy, but before I was even with John, and that's been 41 years now, I used to work in the office for Sweet for David Walker.
Oh, did you?
Yeah. So actually, I do remember quite a lot of what went on. And we all had a lot of fun at Top of the Pops. I do remember that. But as a fellow guitarist, Andy, what did you think of Rick?
Oh, when the two of them locked in, and I did go to quite a few gigs, there was nothing else like it. You know, it was absolutely fantastic. One of Rick's friends recently brought me back from Germany a guitar, because we know the same kind of guitar shops and guitar people around the world, and there was quite a rare Epiphone that this guy had, and I was just wondering how I was going to get it back intact, and one of Rick's mates flew it over and met my mate at Heathrow and handed it over. I mean, it's the kind of thing that, you know, why wouldn't you do that? Do you know what
Fantastic.
I mean? You know, help somebody out, you know?
Oh, I think that's what's so great about the, well, especially the bands from our days. They all helped each other out. Everyone was mates, as everyone's been saying today. We all met up at Stringfellows and the Marquee and the Shass and the Speakeasy and Tramp, and every night there was a party, wasn't there?
Yeah,
yeah. I mean, we used to play the Speakeasy when I was in my band, the Elastic Band. So while you were having hits, John, you were probably sat there with this band in the corner, you know, still plying their wares.
Well, Rick was definitely everybody's party animal, wasn't he? I know Quo used to have have their own bar for after gigs, which was always set up in a hotel room, and Rick was always the cheerleader. What would be your favourite songs of Rick's, and why?
People say that he didn't really sing that much. I've been reading something, you know, in the press, and I thought, well, when I saw him live not that long ago, he was probably singing as much, if not more, than Francis. The two of them singing together is what it's always been about, you know.
And Rick's leads was fantastic on a Blue Eyed Lady, Big Fat Mama, Rain.
Rain. Yeah, fantastic track. The song that keeps coming back to me, and I'm not sure who actually wrote it or whatever, is the song Down, Down, because when I heard that, I thought to myself, I wish we'd done that. great guitar intro, and it cooks like Jamie Oliver. It's fantastic.
It really does, and we will certainly hear Down, Down. And it was their only British number one.
Yeah, it was.
Was the only official number one. If there's anything else you want to share with us about anything you remember about Rick, please do.
Part of my problem is I used to have fairly sensible conversations with him whenever we met in airports and things like that. So all the wild man stuff, I'm afraid, has just slightly passed me by. He only ever came across as a really, really nice guy and a lovely bloke. And, you know, if anything, we used to talk cars more than anything.
Yeah.
You know, we both loved the old anything with a bit of speed, you know, like an Aston or, something like that.
Boys and their toys. Well, yeah, Rick will certainly always be remembered for his great love of cars and blondes. Nothing wrong with that.
No.
Andy, thank you so much for your time. That's been absolutely brilliant.
We'll have to toast him at the next rock and roll lunch, won't we?
We certainly will.
Definitely.
Oh,
And that was Andy's favourite Quo track, Down Down. We owe a lot to our next guest, Alan G. Parker, as he brought back together the original Quo lineup for his documentary Hello Quo, which in fact led to the reunion tours in 2013 and 14. He began by telling us his first memories of seeing Quo.
Both me and my brother were music fans from being about 8 to 9 years of age. And my father was a music fan, although he's a jazz fan. He would take us to rock and roll shows. So our first ever baptism of fire was 1973. We saw Slade and the Alex Harvey Band. And then about 4 or 5 weeks later, we went to Manchester Apollo to see Status Quo. And I was blown away.
And what gave you the idea for the movie, and how did that all come about?
We'd just done the Monty Python film. I'd gone up to see my mother in Blackburn, Lancashire. And I got a call from a pal of mine. And he said, oh, great, brilliant, you're in town, so we're going tonight then, are we? I said, going where? It's like the first or second week of September. And he said, oh, Quo are playing King George's Hall. So I said, well, I hadn't come up to see Quo, I've come to see my mum. I said, but as they're on, it seems silly being on the doorstep and missing the show. So I rang up Quo's press guy down in London. I remember this. I said to him, could I get a guest list? He said, oh, my God, please, there's nobody on the guest list tonight. So how many do you need? So I told him, and we went off there. And literally about 3 songs into the set, my mate John put his hand on my knee, and he just leans across and went, you could do a lot worse than this lot. He said, this is a good story. So I literally stood up, and I walked outside the venue, put my mobile phone back on, rang Alexa down in London and went, what about Status Quo? And she said, oh, that's a good story, you know, and especially if, you know, if we could get to everybody. So we set up a meeting with Simon Porter.
Quo's manager.
And we sat down with him and we told him what our thoughts were. And we said, you know, look, we know there's been previous documentaries, but our kind of plan is, we'd really love to do it. But B, we'd be really even more impressed about doing it if we were 100% sure that we could get Francis and Rick and Alan and John. And he his face lit up like he'd just about to tell us about a big lottery win. And he said, well, funny you should say that, but as of 3 weeks ago, everyone's speaking again. And we went, oh, wow, okay, well, then good, that's cool. And the rest, you know, it was all about making phone calls and seeing how quickly we could get everybody together. I'm pretty sure, if my fading memory serves, that when we first started doing the interviews, there was no actual plan at that point for the band to get together at Shepperton and do that jam session at all.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was the jam session at Shepperton, the first time the four of them were in a room together since John had left. We'd all seen each other individually, but the four of them had never been in a room together since John had left in 81, until that moment of the jam session at Shepperton, where Quo then and now still rehearse. And
well,
that's when it sounded so fantastic and everyone looked at each other and went, whoa.
I've heard a lot of people take the credit for that one. I'll be honest, this is the 100% honest truth. We were sat at home one night, having just interviewed Brian May that day, and we were chatting away, and I said to Alexa something about, of course, if you were doing a Queen movie and Fred was still here, you know how you'd finish it, don't you? And Alexa looked at me like I'd arrived from Mars and said, all four of them are still here, so how do you want to finish it? And then we put it in, and nothing ever came back that was remotely negative. It was all positive. And then before I knew where I was, the mobile phone rang one morning, and it was Rick, because we were going up to Shepperton to do a meeting with the band. And he went, I believe you're getting the Ugly Buggers together, aren't you? And I said, I believe we are. And he said, well done, mate, well done. So that was that.
What would your favourite tracks be that he wrote or sang on, or your memories of Rick playing?
I love For You, and it goes there. I'll tell you why. The first steady girlfriend out of school, that's as dated as all instantly, but we were Ed Oriel's In Love With Each Other, and that was our song. It's as simple as that. I loved Living on an Island for obvious reasons. Bizarrely enough, when I first heard it, I had no idea it was a true story.
That's everybody's favourite.
It's just
magnificent.
Fantastic. I love that.
And you love Accident Prone too, don't you? Which is,
let me tell you a funny story related to the film and indeed related to me. playing really high up the charts. That's my memory. And then along came Accident Prone, which, as far as I was concerned, was the best of the whole batch of about the last five singles, and it disappeared without a trace. And I just remember sitting there and thinking, well, what's just happened? Yeah. Surely it can't just be me. Surely it's been more than me thinks Accident Prone's a great song.
I remember Rick said there was a very long intro of Rick just playing that guitar riff. Pitt Williams said, yeah, okay, Rick, I'll leave it in. Yeah. Anyway, the day came when we were listening back to it, and it all been sort of mixed, and of course, it was short.
Yeah.
It was only about a bar long, and then all the band came in, and Rick went mad. He said, oh my God, you know, where's the intro gone? Oh, we couldn't keep the intro too long because it'd make it, you know, more than 4 minutes.
Yeah.
So I remember Rick getting quite upset, and I thought his idea was superb because it's got this chugging long riff. And I thought it was a great song, lovely.
But, well, we have a lot to thank you for, Alan, I mean, for producing that movie, for getting the band back together again, which sadly can never happen again now. We know Rick desperately wanted it to carry on, the Frantic Four, so thank you so much for that, Alan, and thank you for your time today.
Thanks for having me, the pair of you. It's an absolute pleasure every time, and I will just say this for everybody who's listening. Status quo, brilliant, longevity, everything. But if you want status quo as it should be, what it says on the actual bag when you buy it from the gardener's shop, you want it to be Francis and Rick and Alan and John, and as Jill just said, that won't happen again, but that's Frantic Four.
And that was Accident Prone, a track we don't get to hear very often, but I think is a great Quo track. Our final guest on this special Rockers Rolling tribute to our dear departed friend Rick Parfitt is someone we've both known for all his life and who knew Rick really well, his son, Rick Parfitt Jr.
We've had lots of memories today from people who knew him professionally, but what was he like as a dad?
Oh, gosh, there's a question. I mean, this is the thing that so many people don't get. When they've spoken to me in the past and, you know, you get to meet a lot of people along the way, they sort of always assume he was always a rock star, but he wasn't. You know, he was dad. For whatever reasons, when mom and dad split up, I didn't see him for a few years. But when we got back together again, you know, a few years later, it was like we'd never sort of been apart, and we forged this amazingly tight friendship as well as a sort of a paternal thing. He was challenging at the best of times, but he had this very, very kind streak in him, which was awesome. You know, he was a very fun dad to be around, that's for sure.
Tell us about some of your adventures in race cars and motor cars.
Yeah, I mean, my first word was car, so that was pretty much it. You know, there was only going to be two careers for me, music and motorsport, and luckily I'm able to do both. And this is one of my earliest memories, I think. He had this massive Range Rover, and he had these huge, huge wheels put on it. I remember when it was sort of particularly rainy, he'd literally like, right, let's go and find big puddles, and we could drive out and literally just go and drive through as many big puddles in the Range Rover as possible. So, yeah, I always loved cars. And Dad always had amazing cars over the years. But he never was clever enough to sort of keep the ones which would appreciate. He'd always just chop yep. them in and get yep. something else, usually at a massive loss.
So, always at a massive loss, so, wasn't it?
At a massive, huge, huge loss.
I remember Rick bought the most wonderful, beautiful-looking Rolls-Royce, a blue one. I loved it. And he said, after about a couple of months, he said, Spud, I'm fed up with this. I'm going to get rid of it. I said, no, keep it. And he sold it and got a Porsche, I think.
Yeah, it's right. We've got all these old photos. And, you know, I go through them, and as a car lover, I'm like, oh, my God, I can't believe. What were you doing? That should have just been put into a garage and, you know, left. But he was always like that. You know, he was very impetuous on that level. But as a dad, he was great. I mean, I remember when I was 21 that I suffered from an illness called Crohn's disease, and I lost most of my late teenage years to the illness, and I was very, very thin, very, very unwell. But in those days, I had a massive bowel resectomy where they took out a whole section of my bowel. Basically, it took me, you know, a very, very long time to recover from this. And I remember, you know, at 21, you know, you want to be setting the world alight. But there yeah. I was, you know, weighing just over 5.5 stone and just like thinking, what's going to happen? And I remember coming home when I was starting to convalesce. He knew I'd had a really tough year. And I'd seen this Suzuki Vitara in a friend of ours' garage. Actually, you know, Hugh's garage.
Yeah.
Yes, indeed.
And it looked like a giant roller skate. It had big wheels on it and all that. And I was just like, oh, one day I'll maybe have a car that is that cool. And I remember we were sort of upstairs at the apartment, and he said to me, oh, did you put the alarm on the garage and stuff? And I was like, I can't remember. And so I sort of hobbled downstairs, and the Suzuki was sort of was there, all polished up, aww, with the sort of wheels turned in. He just went, happy 21st. Aww. And if I have to be honest, that was an amazing moment. I brought tears to my eyes. I couldn't yeah. believe it after everything they'd done. So, aww, you know, he was capable of doing some very, very cool things.
That's just such a lovely memory and so typical of him, isn't it?
Yeah, this yeah. is.
And it's bringing tears to all our
many,
tears
many
all
frustrating
our,
moments along the way as well. They're probably best not recounted, to be honest.
Oh, go on.
No, too many to choose from.
Oh. You
know, he was as equally wonderful as he was frustrating. That's probably the best way to put it. JC, I've actually got a white Range Rover as well.
No.
Can you
really
know? And I actually posted a picture, because there was a picture of me when I was a kid. Dad bought me one of those mini ones, you know, the tiny, the kid ones.
Oh, yes.
So he was sat on the bonnet of that, and I was sat on the bonnet of the big one.
Oh.
And I actually did a picture. It's on my Instagram if anyone wants to check it.
Yeah, yeah.
And with me sitting on the bonnet of this one, I said, you know, nothing much changes over the years.
And you will remember that at your wonderful wedding, which I have to say is the best wedding that John and I have ever been to in our lives in Malaga.
It was a great wedding.
It was the best wedding band ever, because it was your band with John on drums yeah. for a couple of numbers and your dad on guitar. So it was yeah. quite an amazing wedding.
Oh, you know, Mr. Rick and me got off stage after we played two or three songs, and I remember Rick saying to me, he said, my God, that was loud. And I said, no, RPJ's not loud. I said, Quo's loud. He said, is yeah. it?
I think he really struggled with the in-ear thing as well, and so I think his hearing was ever so slightly impaired from those years, you know, so all good.
What are your favourite songs from your angle that he's written? What would be your choices?
There's so many great songs to choose from, but my sort of personal favourite, which I've just thought is just straightforward and Heads Down, which I just thought was just such a great song, was one he sung called Rain from the early days. It's just a brilliant song. And from the slightly more modern era, he wrote a song called One Man Band, which was on the Rock Till You Drop album. And the last one, I guess, was pretty obvious, which is just a beautiful song, is Living on an Island.
Oh, thank you. Well, as you can imagine, every single one of our guests has picked Living on an Island. It's just a complete classic that we all love to bits.
Do you know, Rick, it's amazing because at that time, you know, your dad was living in Jersey. I was living in the Isle of Man. And Adam was in Australia, and I think Francis went to Ireland. But anyway, the reason I mention this is because all the Manx people were saying, well, Mr. Coghlan, you wrote that about the Isle of Man. I said, no. I can just about do a Manx accent.
And, they were all Dutch, evidently, yeah.
Dutch Manx. That's it. We've started something here, Rick. Dutch Manx. they thought I wrote. I said, no. I said, Rick wrote that. It was about Jersey. And when I mentioned Jersey, it was like, because, you know, the Isle of Man and Jersey, they're both different. And you think, well, you know, one's in the sunshine, one's in the rain. And guess where we lived?
John picked, Rick? Where did I go wrong?
Yeah, but let's be honest, it's probably more of an exciting island, isn't it? Because you've got the TT there every year. So, you know, that must have been amazing.
And that was Rick Jr.'s choice of one of his favourites of his dad's songs, Rain. You're listening to our Rockers Rolling tribute to the lovely Rick Parfitt, and our final guest is his son, Rick Jr. I asked him if his dad supported him or not in his guitar playing and singing.
Well, I mean, he was never massively supportive, I would say, of music. I don't know whether he thought that perhaps it wasn't the greatest choice of career, or I don't really know. I mean, he was a very competitive man, and I sort of in later life, it was always a bit like, it was always sort of a competitiveness. If I ever played him anything that I'd written or anything, you know, he'd sort of rip it to shreds, basically. And equally with the performance. he found it very difficult to compliment. And I think that's probably because I think his father was actually very, very hard on him as well. And so perhaps that's the reason why he sort of adopted that approach with me. However, there were moments. I didn't play the guitar for years. And so I went sort of played piano. But and my band, which is called the RPJ Band, which you guys know, we play all over the world for big corporates. I went a different route to the commercial angle, and I could still make a living out of music, but I wouldn't have to go with the fame route, because at the end of the day, it's always very difficult to come out of your father's shadow, especially when he's as well known as he was. But he always kind of fought against it a little bit. But I remember there was one night we actually played on the same bill. We were booked for the same big event at the Grosvenor in London, and Quo went on before us and really, really hammered it. And I sort of put my arms around my band and went, right, boys, well, that is going to be tough to beat, but let's just go out and do what we do. And we went on and absolutely ripped the roof off the place. It was incredible. And I thought Dad had left, but actually what had happened was he'd actually stayed on. The rest of the band had left, but he stayed on. And I saw him at the back of the crowd. You know, there was about 1,000 people there. And he sort of wandered his way through and sort of grabbed my hand and gave my hand a kiss. And that was the first time. And he sort of just went, aren't they great? And everyone was like hugging him, going, oh, they're so good. That was another tearjerker of a moment for me.
Oh,
I was like,
that's
finally
fabulous.
Finally vindication.
I think he was very, very proud of you. We all know he was very, very proud of you.
It's very difficult if your parent is successful. It's actually very difficult to also be successful, especially if you're going to the same career, basically.
Which is why it was very clever of you to go down the corporate route. RPJ were never going to compete with Quo, which was a very clever thing to do. Yeah, absolutely.
Well, absolutely. And it was never meant to. I mean, years ago, everyone was assuming I had to sound a certain way and I had to do something when I was originally doing that. And so I then sort of just went, no, this isn't for me. And I went a different route. You know, in the last few years, he's actually played with us a lot. And he loves my boys, and he loved it, and it was just so much fun. And I think when he came and played with us, I don't think he felt any of the pressures of being with the band and the politics and whatever was going on. With us, he could just like unleash, and we had so much fun. You know, when whether we were in rehearsals, we played an amazing gig for a huge company to about sort of 3,500 people, I think, a huge conference they had at London XL. And he joined us on stage and played the last half an hour with us, and the place went absolutely nuts. It was great. And this is the interesting thing, is that he was such a humble person, really. And as I said in his eulogy as well, I truly believe that he didn't actually think he was any good. I think he had a constant battle with his security as a musician and as a songwriter. And when he was around people who had achieved so much, from Queen and all these people who you guys knew, I think he felt a little bit, you know, insecure around them, because I think truly deeply he didn't believe he was as good as people thought he was. And
he was amazing. And he never changed at all, did he? I mean, as John and the others were saying, he never changed. He was always the same fun-loving guy that they met at Butlin's all those years ago.
John, you've been back and played there as well, haven't you?
You know, really, for us, it was so nice to go back there and play, because that's where I met your dad, where I met Rick.
Because I've read all about this, obviously, and he's told me all about it, and I've seen the pictures of you guys, which, obviously, for anyone listening, you know, John and all the rest of the boys, they were quite devilishly handsome in those days. I'm trying to think what you got up to in Butlins. But however, you know, we were able to play there as well. We were booked as part of a big sort of a rock weekend. I can't remember what it was. And they invited us to come down and headline on Friday night. And it was weird because I hadn't thought about it. And then I got to this place, which, weirdly enough, I've heard so much about. But there was definitely a weird sort of a connection where I thought, well, this is where it all happened with the guys. And what's more is that I truly believe the best, for me, I mean, for all people listening and sort of Quo fans, I think the best era was when it was Frantic Four. But obviously, I was a kid so I couldn't really take it in. But in 2013, you guys had a reunion, and I managed to come to the Hammersmith gig, and just the reaction of the crowd, it was euphoric from the first moment. And to hear you guys playing together, where it was just pure and heavy and awesome, and just the arrangements are difficult, and all these things and platitudes that people sort of say about Quo, I mean, are just dispelled, because you guys were absolutely incredible. And I went away thinking, well, that's just completely messed up me seeing another Quo show, because for me, that's it. There it is. That was the band that was great. And well, that's the way I feel about it.
Yeah, and you know, there was, and Rick, your lovely dad said to me, he said, that's how I want it to play. That's how I want to, quote, to be, is with that power. And your dad was the best rhythm guitarist in the world.
Thank you, mate. Thank you.
Well, oh, and he so wanted nice to carry on. Oh, sorry, I've got to say, John is. John's filling up here.
Oh no, oh, don't.
You. Oh, I know your dad wanted to carry on doing it with John and Alan so much, yeah, and there were plans to do stuff together this year, which would have been amazing.
There were plans.
And so we all miss him.
Incredible.
We all miss him so much, Rick.
Oh, John, I wish I could give you a hug, mate.
Oh, well. That was emotional for all of us. That was the lovely Rick Parfitt Jr., who, as we said earlier, we've known all his life, and he is just a great credit to his wonderful dad. Thank you so much to all our guests. We had so many more people who wanted to come on this show and pay tribute to Rick, and we could have played dozens more of Rick's great songs as well.
And I'd like to say to all our guests, thank you for your kind comments.
We hope you've enjoyed this Rockers Rolling tribute to Rick Parfitt.
And my song is a fabulous song that Rick wrote and sang and played guitar. I just love this mystery song.
Rollin' with John and Gillie Coghlan.
This is BBC Radio Oxford.